If true, this would be the first attack that ISIS takes credit for on American soil. The significance of that to you?
Well, we knew this was coming in some fashion or another. They'd been making these kind of threats. They've said that they're going to fly their flag over our White House. They're willing to do suicide attacks about anywhere in the world. And so it was going to happen eventually in the United States. This situation, the event that was going on in Garland, Texas, if someone would have told me that this happened somewhere in America, I think I could have told you where it was without having been told, because of the high-value targets, according to them, that were there on that stage and in that building. And they wanted to send a statement that you shall not put any cartoons of Muhammad out. They're going to they're bringing in Sharia law into America by intimidation factors driven by ISIS.
We'll talk about the event and what makes things better and worse going forward. But do you believe that ISIS was behind this? Have you received any intelligence about it? Or do you think that these two guys, whether people saw it or not, were lone wolf types who were just trying to get themselves false glory?
Well, right now what we know is that they predicted this in advance. They'd been doing some planning. We don't quite know how long that planning's been going on. And how does ISIS coordinate? By sometimes just by inspiration and by sending the messages around the world in the internet. So I don't know that you can say that ISIS said go to Garland, Texas and attack that location and that activity. But there's certainly part of the psychological approach of this that causes people to be radicalized.
What do you think about the Gaylor event? Is it about free speech and showing that in America we embrace freedom, or was it just using that as a cover to poke Islam in the eye?
Well, first, that's a little bit of a hard question to answer in that if we start down the path of thinking if we know something's going to offend someone, so we should retreat from that, they keep redefining what's offensive until then all of their rules are applied on all of us in our free world and our Western civilization. So I think we have to push back on this. I don't think that what they did down there was offensive. I think it was a robust just demonstration of freedom of speech, and we have to do that. If a speech is not offensive, it doesn't need to be protected by our First Amendment Constitution. In fact, Geert Wilders, who was there to give the keynote speech, spoke in Washington, D.C. at actually four events that I planned for him just the week before.
Yeah.
And in each one of those events, as I recall, he spoke about how glad he is we have the First Amendment, how much he wishes they did in Western Europe.
What are you boosting Wilders for? I mean, he said some things that are pretty ugly about Islam that is not breeding any type of cooperation of faiths and moving forward together. What are you supporting him for? Why are you inviting him to Congress?
Well, I've been tracking him for about 10 years, and I think that he's been unjustly attacked, especially in Europe. They're the political correctness, the restraints on our culture and civilization that come from the politically correct cause us to retreat away from our civilization. And as he says, that Western civilization is superior, and we need to understand why it's superior. I often talk about the pillars of American exceptionalism, and when I do go to Europe, I talk about how we need to strengthen and expand Western civilization.
Right.
That is the clash going on here.
What makes America great as a culture, as you well know, is what we do by example. Not that we say we're better than everybody else. I mean, that's not American. And this guy Wilders, he's got some bad checks on his record. And I'm sure you know this if you've been following him that long. His own country has accused him of inciting violence. He calls Islam the ideology of a retarded culture. You know, he's a provocative guy, and he's trying to divide people. Why would you invite that into Congress, which is the body of a country that's all about collaboration between cultures?
I think we need to understand at us, and that's what Geert Wilders is doing, is helping the world understand what's coming at us. He's written a book called Marked for Death. I picked it up and I thought I would read an autobiography about him having to live under guard for 10 years because radical Islamists didn't like what he said and did. That's not freedom. He hasn't had freedom for a decade. But when I read his book, I found out that he understands radical Islam. He's read through the Quran at least twice that I can pick up out of that. He's written a historical narrative that's nailed together factually, that's very well footnoted. I think this country's not at all educated on what we have for an enemy. And Geert Wilders opens this up for us and forces us to take a deeper look at the people that are coming to kill us, as they did in Garland, Texas, just Sunday night.
But the risk is that you wind up painting the whole as just a function of the extreme. same. And let's look at it by analogy, Congressman. If Wilders were saying that Christianity is an ideology of the retarded and the Bible should be outlawed, you wouldn't invite him to Congress.
Well, no, I wouldn't invite him to Congress, but I did invite him to Washington, D.C. to do those events because we need to have this kind of dialogue.
Yeah, but you wouldn't have it if he was saying something you didn't like.
One of those that says,
you know, I mean, if he was saying it about Christianity, you wouldn't do this.
He says that he has no problem with the Muslim religion. It's the Islamists that he has a problem with. And the peaceful component of Islam, or the Muslim religion, they are irrelevant in this discussion, except to the extent that they help. They're the stream within which swim the violent Islamists. It's coming at us, and we're accelerating it in this country. I have been into the inner cities in Europe, into places like The Hague and into Brussels that have been taken over by Islam, and the no-go zones that are all over Europe. And we've probably got some no-go zones in America that we don't. I haven't been to them. I need to do that. But if you go to Europe and see what's happening in Europe, it's a predictor of what's happening here in America. That's why he's here. He's hang on to your First Amendment, your right of freedom to speech. He's been prosecuted for hate speech. And the truth is not an affirmative defense. So you can't speak the truth in Europe if it happens to a. We don't want a country like that, and he's reminding us of that. There are principles more important than the politically correct side of this, and those are right there in the Bill of Rights, but especially the First Amendment of our Constitution.
Right.
He's an advocate for that, wishes they had
that
in Europe,
how he's using
and I'm glad we have it
it's
here.
It's how he's using it, and I guess you just have to ask yourself, what is it that you want to promote? I mean, do you believe that America's future when it comes to collaboration of cultures is to pick on one and paint one in the extreme and at its ugliest, or do you want to try to cultivate the moderates within Islam and show them that they're welcome in this country? I mean, that's really the debate, and we'll continue having it, Congressman. I appreciate you coming on New Day, as always, with your perspective. We'll see you again soon.
Thank you, Chris. You got to know your enemy.
All right, Nick. Thank you very much.